Well, good evening. Good evening. You know, for many years of my life, I would start out public addresses with, is this a great day to be a soldier or what? Now, today I'll say, okay, is this a great day to be a New Yorker or what? Is this a great day to be here with veteran writers or what? It's really a privilege to be here with you this evening. My name's Loree Sutton. I'm privileged to serve as the commissioner for the Department of Veteran Services right here in New York City, and it's just really a delight to be with you and to be able to celebrate and explore the experiences and the talents and time and energy of these veteran writers who are with us this evening. So let's not waste another second. Let's get started. I'm going to ask each of our veteran writers to give just a two-minute introduction, what they want us to know about themselves and how they got into writing, and then we'll get after some questions among the panel members, and then we'll open it up for some Q&A. That's really when the fun starts, isn't it? Deal? Okay, great. Kristen Rouse.
Good evening, everybody, and thanks for coming. My name is Kristen Rouse. I'm a veteran of the United States Army. I served in Afghanistan in 2006 and 2010 and 2012. As part of my service, I've served in the reserve, active duty, and National Guard. I served 13 years enlisted, including 3 years on active duty. And then I went to the National Guard, and I'm presently in the reserve as an officer. And so so I've had a fair span of experiences in the Army. I feel like I've lived many different Army lives. But part of coming home from my most recent deployment was getting involved with what veterans were doing in New York City. And an important part of what veterans have been doing in New York City, especially recently, has been writing workshops. So I'm one of the kind of weirdos who went into the Army with degrees in English. I went to Loyola New Orleans and Florida State and have degrees in English literature. Never considered myself much of a writer other than a bunch of opinions. That's kind of still who I am. But I ended up getting involved in 2013 after I came home from my last deployment with some great workshops that are being run. Warrior Writers was a great community for me to start getting involved with, and then that was sort of the gateway to others, which included Voices from War, run by Kara Krause, and then Words After War, run by Brandon Willits, who's one of the contributors to this book, and it may be more important than the actual sitting down and having this workshop is being introduced to an incredible community of veteran writers. And veterans aren't just writing, they're also doing a lot of stuff. And so that also was part of my lead-in to being an advocate in New York City and forming the startup nonprofit advocacy organization, the New York City Veterans Alliance, which occupies a lot of my time. Veterans are doing great things in New York City, and more than anything, I hope if you're not a part of that in this room, then please know that veterans are doing incredible things in this city, and I can't wait to see what this is going to look like in another 1 year, 5 years, 10 years.
Again, thank you all for coming. Standing room only. You can't ask for more in New York. My name is Brian Castner. I'm one of the editors of the anthology. I was in the Air Force for 8 years. I was an officer. I was explosive ordnance disposal. That's the bomb squad. I did a couple tours in Iraq, wrote a book about that called The Long Walk, about time in Iraq and the challenges of coming home. I did 8 years. I became a contractor, and then I became a writer. I had a story I needed to get out. I never expected that a publisher would want to publish it or would lead to all the things that it has since. But I'm a nonfiction writer now. Mostly, I had a new book, All the Ways We Kill and Die, came out earlier this year. This is one of our first forays into fiction for several of us, and it was for me as well. So let me pass it on.
Good evening. My name is Chris Wolfe. I'm originally from Fayetteville, North Carolina. Currently a resident in Brooklyn. And I kind of have a long rap sheet. So Like I said, I'm from Fayetteville, North Carolina. Spent about 6 years in the military. I was a field artillery officer. I deployed to Iraq in 2003 with the 3rd Armored Cavalry Regiment. That was a very interesting year for me. So I returned from Iraq, went to business school at Duke University, met my lovely wife, baby, raise your hand, right there. and then moved up here to New York and worked on Wall Street for a little while at a firm that no longer exists. It was actually when I was with that firm that I found myself kind of scribbling on those little kind of post-it notes. I started writing little stories and poems, and I found myself at my desk at work, you know, kind of looking like I was writing out an equation, but I was really writing out like some good dialogue. And that's when I had to pitch to my wife, like, hey, baby, this is what I love to do. And fortunately, you know, I think as veterans, you know, it makes it easier to do what we do when we have the support of you all out there. So, you know, my wife supported me, decided to go to Columbia for an MFA, and I'm here now, so.
Thanks, Chris. I think we've got Elliot.
Hi, my name's Elliot Ackerman. I'm a novelist and journalist. I've lived in Istanbul, Turkey for the past 2.5 years. I wrote a novel that came out in 2015 called Green on Blue. I have a second novel coming out actually in just a couple of weeks called Dark at the Crossing. It's a love story set on the Turkish-Syrian border. Before that, I was a Marine Corps infantry officer and special operations officer for 8 years and served multiple tours in Iraq and Afghanistan. My mother was a novelist, or is a novelist, and sort of grew up around books, studied history and literature at school. I guess that's, you know, how I first started writing and, you know, took a long detour in the wars.
Cool. Hi, everyone. My name's Teresa Fazio, and I had a similarly maybe circuitous path towards writing as many of the folks up here. So started out as a physics major in undergrad, actually in the same ROTC unit as Elliot, bizarrely. Neither of us started writing. Yeah. half our lives now, oddly. And then, you know, graduated, joined the Marine Corps, and served 4 years as a communications officer. I deployed to Iraq. Came back, and when I decided to get out, I did grad school in science, and you know, did a PhD in materials science, and wrote an entire PhD thesis before realizing this isn't actually what I want to be writing about. I can't stop thinking about Iraq, so I want to write about that. And part of me said, well, no, I can't write about that. And soon it became all I could write about. So I've written a memoir. I've had some things published in the New York Times in a couple of anthologies. And this is one of my first forays into fiction. But yeah, hope to be writing a lot more.
Great. Well, thanks so much. I think we're off for a great hour of dialogue and discussion and learning and exploration. And I'd like to start out with Chris, maybe you could just share with us. Obviously, each of you here on the panel tonight has come to writing with your own path, your own journey, and yet what's the story of this particular anthology? And it's, as it's listed here, Fiction from the Forever War. How did this all come about? Can you provide some context for us?
Sure, I'd be happy to. I can't take credit for the idea of putting together the anthology. That was Adrian Bonnenberger, who is not here tonight. He's in Ukraine, where he is doing his own journalism and writing. You know, a couple years ago, 4 years ago maybe now, there was a veterans anthology of short fiction that came out called Fire and Forget. Lots of great writers and lots of great stories in there. And I think that what that example showed was that people are interested in reading stories from veteran writers about different aspects of the war. And I guess, you know, we owe them a debt in that there's, it was at least a bit of an inspiration. Adrian said, we should do another one. And then I guess a couple of us said, well, sure, I guess we'll help out. Kristen was there, one of the very first ones. Teresa did a lot of the initial editing with a lot of the stories that came in. Adrian and I, you know, we stuck with it. We went to a lot of different kinds of writers and to put together the anthology. I think our goal from the very beginning was, you know, starting in, I don't know, 2010, 2011, 2012, there was a lot more fiction and nonfiction from veteran writers being published, but very quickly a lot of it started to sound the same. And a lot of it was, well, it's the way I describe it as, I went to war and I feel bad about it. I wrote one of those books, I added to the glut of it. It's my fault too. Now that's a legit war story. People have been writing that war story for a very long time. The most recent best example is probably Tim O'Brien and the things they carried. We know this story. Person maybe wants to go to war, doesn't want to go to war, goes to war, finds something happened. It wasn't what they expected, and they came home and then have to process this. I have a friend at SUNY Buffalo. He calls it shoot and cry as the genre. Again, legit, but it's not the only war story. And so we tried to reach out to as many different kinds of writers as we could. And that's not just men, women, black, white, you know, it's Army, Navy, Air Force, Marine Corps. It's all over the country. We have contributors from the Pacific Northwest and Texas and Michigan. And I'm proud of is I think that the 24 stories we collected don't sound like every other war story. There's some of those, I went to war and I feel bad about it. There's some about, Kristen wrote about Afghan truck drivers. We have a story written from the perspective of the ghosts following a veteran. We have stories that have, you know, they have something to do with war, but only tangentially. We have satire. I think we have a lot of different voices, and at the end of the day, that's what I'm most proud of, is that each story is distinct and has its own voice.
Terrific. Well, I realize that this book, has it just been published? Is that, there are copies tonight that folks
there, are? There are. Technically, it's in a week. So lucky all of you get it a week early.
So I may be one of the few who's actually had a chance to read an advanced copy, and I will tell you, I see some of you who are leafing through the book now. It is definitely, this is definitely beyond what you say, some of sort of the usual genre of war writing, and it really gets into some very nuanced and compelling, intriguing angles of war that I think people, whether or not you've been deployed, perhaps wouldn't have thought of it. So Kristen, I'm going to start with you. You know, almost 3 years deployed in Afghanistan. As you said, your background as a non-commissioned officer, as a commissioned officer, and you wrote this book, this story about truck drivers. Can you just give us a little context of just what was it that kind of, you know, led to this story of truck drivers? And I won't. Spoiler alert, I won't give you any further details other than what you want to share, but it's a fascinating story.
So the jobs that I had during each of my three deployments in Afghanistan were logistics in some way, shape, or form. My first tour, I was a supply sergeant for a company of soldiers that was kind of spread out across eastern Afghanistan. My second tour, I worked 9 months as second in command of a company providing resupply convoys and maintenance support for a battalion of infantrymen. So I was with the infantry, and I also was partnered with Afghan Army counterparts. So I did my 9 months with, you know, doing essentially mission planning, and then also working on a regular basis with logisticians in the Afghan Army. So they were running supply convoys to their soldiers, and I got to know them really well. And then my third tour, I did sort of the big cleanup of retrograde, which was you know, collecting in all of the supplies and equipment and vehicles from, you know, rolling in everybody from the field and bringing it back and putting, you know, giant armored trucks on airplanes and shipping them all over the world. And so the glue of everything that moves around in Afghanistan is Afghan truck drivers. And, you know, you know, Americans run a lot of convoys. There's a lot of military convoys, but to mitigate risk on stuff that, like, it doesn't matter if it gets stolen or blown up or goes away, they ship it by Afghan truck drivers, and those guys do so at risk of life and limb, and we've depended on them, and so what I did was I created a scenario that I knew really well. The story takes place in a holding yard outside of an American base in Paktia province in Gardez, which is where I spent my 9 months when I worked with the Afghans. And I sort of created characters based on people I'd met and gotten to know, and sort of meshed in some of the stories that I got to know of what it was like to serve in the Soviet era Afghan army. And what happened when things didn't go well for them, and I also heard stories from the truck drivers themselves who had been driving, you know, 1 year, 10 years, you know, who knew the supply routes and the combat terrain better than, I would say, 99.9% of Americans, because they'd been there the whole time, as American units change out and change over and relearn the same lessons over and over again. And I also felt like the most important story to tell for me, I mean, you know, everybody's stories are absolutely important, you know, otherwise, you know, they wouldn't move audiences. And also it's part of healing. It's part of, you know, individual healing. It's part of, you know, a generation healing and reintegrating back into society. But I feel like the most important stories that are missing from how we're telling our stories is what's the perspective of the people that we've been interacting with these, you know, what, 15 years now. And I feel like there's so many successes that our armed forces have had in Iraq, Afghanistan, and elsewhere, but our wars have not been successful. And just me personally, I feel like a lot of that lack of success comes from just a lack of understanding of the people that we're interacting with. And so that was why I chose to write from, you know, my limited view of an Afghan perspective.
Thanks. So Brian, you've given us some context for the, you know, sort of evolution of this anthology. Maybe you can also provide some context for how things have really evolved since we initially deployed after 9/11 to Afghanistan, and then of course subsequently to Iraq, but how has this whole evolution over these last now 15 going on 16 years, how has that affected, do you think, the writing, particularly as we're now you know, hearing in the news on a regular basis how things continue to unfold and point to such a complex environment?
Well, I think, so I'm going to steal some of Elliot's thunder. I've heard him say, I've heard him be asked this question a couple times, and I don't know, correct me if I'm wrong, but he said, we're just getting started. Like, the stories to come out of Iraq and Afghanistan, like the ones that you've read, are just the very beginning of it. And I think that as long as publishers keep wanting, you know, there's a big difference between what's being written and what's being published. Right, so there's many, many writers telling lots of stories about Iraq, Afghanistan, Syria, Libya, the greater Middle East, you could go through the list, Africa. There's lots of stories about the post 9/11 wars being written. How many of them make it to you, the reader? That's a publishing question, that's a business question. But as long as publishers keep going, I think that I think the stories are only going to get broader and broader. I think that there's gonna be many more stories like Kristen's, and this is something that has taken longer in previous generations from previous wars. I don't know, somebody correct me if I'm wrong, but I'd have trouble naming a novel from a Japanese or German perspective in, you know, 1948, at least one that was, you know, had a large impact. I think it's a credit to veterans today that in a relatively short period of time, we've tried to tell not just our own stories, but try to like reach out and try to understand and tell a variety of stories from a variety of perspectives. So I'd like to think that there's gonna be more and more of that, and there's also going to be, I don't know, some of these, if I call them tangential, that's not necessarily what I mean, but there's been stories of the main effort But then there's this whole like kaleidoscope of perspectives that go around that. And I think that we'll see more of those. And then eventually the cycle, like, here's the funny thing. There was a time that writing about a young male infantry grunt perspective was progressive by itself, because it wasn't writing from the perspective of the general or the president or whatever else. So I think these things kind of go full circle, and then maybe we'll go get back to like a traditional story again, and that's just the cycle of writing and publishing, which is, again, as much of a business as it is an artistic endeavor.
Thank you. And now, Chris, you know, Chris, you're a long ways off from Fayetteville. And your story, Another Brother's Conviction, you know, starts out a Dominican, an ex-con, and a white girl walk into a bodega. Tell us about that story, Chris, and what led to that story inside you.
Sure. So I think it kind of ties in with what Brian was just saying in terms of like how this fiction is coming out today. For me, this story was partially based on a real life event experience. I enjoy an egg and cheese sandwich in the morning, so I went to the bodega by where I live on the weekend one Saturday. It was a few years ago, probably about 4 or 5 years ago, and a young man came around the corner and saw another young man coming up out of the subway, and they greeted each other, and I was standing there, you know, I was kind of at the entrance about to walk into the bodega. And basically the young man coming off the subway had just been released from prison, and his friend was just so excited to see him. And, you know, I just watched him the entire time and you know, just observed them. And when I got home, you know, one thing I just couldn't get out of my mind was that, you know, that young man, you know, no matter what, you know, no matter the reason why he went to prison, he had served his time and he was home. And I regretted the fact that I didn't say to him, welcome home, because I know that when I came back from Iraq, not to equate going on a deployment to serving time in prison, but I think the common factor between the two is that, you know, you have two folks who just made it back from a place that, you know, they probably didn't know if they'd be making it back from. And you know, I just couldn't get that experience out of my mind. So I just wanted to kind of explore that. And as I was writing it, the conversation kind of expanded. And I just started to think about, you know, that young man who served the conviction for whatever he may or may not have done. You know, I don't know the specifics of his case, but when you think about other folks who have committed certain crimes or, you know, things that are questionable, whether or not they get convicted, and the reason why they may or may not even have a trial. So, you know, just somehow that experience, that moment was one that just expanded to the story that's in the book. So,
well, and sort of at the end, Chris, where you talked about conviction, of course, the title of the story, but I had no conviction. There was no conviction. There still is no conviction. Very poignant, drawing from your experiences. I really appreciate you sharing your perspective. We'll dig into that in the Q&A a little bit more. Thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you for being game to give Chris the top cover to pursue his art's craft. So now on to you, Elliot. Both of your novels, as I understand them, they feature foreign sort of protagonists, Afghans and Arabs. You're now living in Istanbul. But the short story in this collection is about American soldiers. And particularly, I was just drawn by this drive within Sergeant Garcia, who didn't feel like he could go home and hold his head up without.
The story that I offered in the collection is about a guy who really wants to get a combat action ribbon, which for those of you who aren't familiar with it, it's if you're a Marine or a sailor, it's, you know, just a little ribbon you wear on your chest. It's red, yellow, blue, and it just means you've been in a firefight. someone shot at you. And my experience in the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, because you get a new combat action ribbon for every theater you're in. So if you go to Afghanistan, you get another one, is guys would show up and the first thing they would feel, you know, anxiety and, you know, loss of sleep over would be like, God, when am I going to get shot at so I've got my combat action ribbon? Like, wouldn't it be the worst thing ever if I left here after 7 months, a year, and I didn't even have a combat action ribbon? And, you know, it frequently happens. And so, you know, I came across, and, you know, I felt myself that same anxiety, you know, a lot of infantrymen who, you know, would be 3 or 4 months into a deployment and would be obsessed and feeling real fear that they were going to go home without this thing. So the story that I wrote is basically about a guy who's about to go home from his deployment, and he wants his combat action ribbon, and he sort of engineers, or he goes out on patrol and kind of as aggressively is chasing this thing. People say, you know, you're chasing the car, you're chasing the combat action ribbon. And he winds up basically engineering a set of circumstances by which he gives himself a self-inflicted, he has a self-inflicted wound so he can receive this combat action ribbon. And, you know, in my mind, that was just sort of an exploration of, you know, we traditionally, you know, we have these sort of stories, these narratives, like if you remember, like maybe the last scene of Platoon, there's a scene where a guy gives himself a self-inflicted wound. And that's something that a reluctant soldier often does. But it was this idea that that the fear to not have that experience and to not have been proven in that crucible would be greater than whatever fears existed around that crucible. So you take that action of a self-inflicted wound, but to try to sort of turn it on its head and show that someone gives themselves a self-inflicted wound to show that they've actually been in combat. So that was sort of what, you know, what I was trying to do in the story, and also trying to challenge a little bit maybe what we often think of as a soldier, a Marine's greatest fear, which is, you know, getting shot or wounded in battle. But at least amongst, you know, many of the folks I was with, it was coming out the back end of the experience without having fully had the experience, which if you think of it as intuitive, because by and large these are people who've volunteered to have that experience, and why does it surprise us when they go there that they actually meant it and they actually want to have that experience? And so I think war is a interesting place where you can kind of have a real funhouse, you know, there's a real funhouse mirror effect in terms of what's going on, you know. And just to make a final point too, and I think we also underestimate how much there's a feedback loop that exists in wars where you have young guys who, you know, and girls who go to war, and they have a conception of war that's often fed by, you know, films and what they've read. And then when they go to war, they imitate those exact same things. So, you know, I remember I fought in the Second Battle of Fallujah, and I remember at one point in that battle looking at my platoon, and suddenly, you know, I mean, we're in it. We're in a battle full on. And, you know, suddenly the guys have, like, gone cross machine gun bandoliers across their chests. One of my lance corporals had like a royal flush that he was wearing in his helmet band, and like they just dressed up from like the cast of Full Metal Jacket. But I'm like, you guys understand, like, you're actually those guys, and someone might make a movie about you pretending to be in a movie. So anyways, but you know, these are things, and so these are some of the things I try to get in that story, and some of the surreality that exists in war.
Great, thank you. Teresa, your story sort of flips the script on roles, sexual relationships, and really features a higher-ranking female officer really being tugged, pulled towards having an inappropriate relationship with a junior officer, male officer. What, you know, as the writer, were you drawn towards exploring the power dynamics, the gender reversal dynamics? What really kind of led you towards telling this story, which really does, I have to say, for those of you who have not yet read it, it's an intriguing play on what our usual expectations might be in learning about sexually inappropriate relationships. What would you say?
Sure. Because everybody wants to be the writer who gets asked that question. Yeah, absolutely. And I, yeah, went into this figuring I might get that. So one of the themes that I really try to write about, especially when I'm writing about war, is that people are human, and you don't stop being human just because you put on a uniform. And, you know, much as you may try to stave them off, everybody has those human feelings. I will give everybody a little bit of a window, the story behind the story, because I am very analytical, and so I actually tried writing this story in every different tense that I could think of, in the first person, second person, and third person. And originally I had thought about flipping the genders, but when I switched the positions to make the woman senior and more the aggressor and 10 years older, I was like, wait a minute, that feels different. And so I kind of exposed my own, you know, prejudices there as to what I felt was more typical or appropriate. And in this case, I went with the more unusual kind of relationship that maybe you don't hear about, but, you know, people always have feelings. And of course, the most appropriate thing to do is not act on them. But my story, you know, kind of tells about people wrestling literally and figuratively with those feelings. So I won't offer any spoiler alerts or anything like that. But that's what I thought about. I did want to mention one more thing with a little bit of airtime, is that I have noticed a couple other writers in the anthology in the audience, Nate Bethia, PJ Frederick, and if anybody else is here, you know, please raise your hand.
All other writers in the anthology, you know, please raise your hands now so we can recognize you. And we will be expecting particularly insightful questions and observations from you.
So if anybody, you know, was looking for other folks who wrote, I know there's a lot of vet writers.
Terrific. And there are about 25 writers in this anthology? 24. Okay, well, great. Well, that gives you a little snapshot view of some of the different perspectives and angles and thoughts of the writers themselves as they were writing these stories. Let's open it up to any of you in the audience. You know, across the panel here, please. What are your questions? What are your comments, observations? Who's going to be the, yes, right here.
Yes, George, and we need you in them. So for those of you who don't know George Broadhead, the man, the myth, the legend, he's a Korean War vet and a writer and an inspiration to those of us who've had the honor of being in a writing workshop with him. Absolutely, because you may not know you're a writer until you start writing, and it may turn out to be really good and exactly what the world needs to know. Everyone needs to tell their story, period. It may not be the most literary story, but it starts with telling your story. And so whether a writing workshop for veterans or actually like anybody, writing workshops are great, period. But you know, writing workshops that bring together veterans with, you know, veterans across generations has been an incredible thing, definitely in my life. And then also workshops like Words After War that are really specific about bringing in veterans and civilians writing about this thing we've been doing for the last 15 years. Because everybody has a perspective to share on that, and it's not just veterans. And so the interaction is what, like, that kind of deeper interaction is what I think everybody needs to be doing.
Any other thoughts, Teresa?
Yeah, sure. I'd say that veterans writing and sharing their stories with other veterans has a therapeutic effect sometimes, depending on how personal the story is. But I certainly was never more scared to share my own nonfiction as in front of a room of other veterans who I knew that they could tell if I was trying to bullshit them or myself. So they would call me out on anything. And so they, you know, were some of my most warm critics, I think, of some of the things that I wrote, and it almost felt like it was a permission to say things that I didn't feel like I could say or write about or share in front of, you know, people who knew me in other contexts.
Great. You know, and I have to say, I'm going to call out my sweetie here, Loree. She's in the front row with Ellen Greeley, my secret weapon at the Department of Veteran Services. On the way here, we were talking, and one of the questions Loree raised was, she said, I'd be curious to know from the writers, you know, what's the experience like writing nonfiction versus going the fiction route as you did in this anthology? Any thoughts on the differences, similarities, the experience of fiction versus nonfiction?
I wrote both. I sort of one of my like pet peeves. I kind of bristle at the distinction between fiction and nonfiction, because I think it's really something that is a little bit of a fixation we have on providing everything into its appropriate genre. You know, a friend of mine who's a poet likes to say one of the great things about being a poet is there's no fiction or nonfiction poetry. It's just poetry. And so, I think how many times have you read a novel that is obviously an extremely autobiographical novel and it's being pitched to you, the consumer, as a novel, or, you know, you read a work of nonfiction where, you know, stylistically they're doing lots of extremely creative things. It's structurally very, very interesting. I mean, it could practically be a novel. So I think sometimes it blocks people off from readers finding those books. And, you know, how many people did you hear up here say, you know, they wrote a short story, and that's a work of fiction, but it's based off of something that happened to them, you know, and vice versa. You know, when I'm writing nonfiction, you know, your job is you have to make this interesting. So you have to be looking for the specific nuggets you're going to pull out, and you're not just making yourself a complete scribe to the events as they occur. So I think that there's artistry behind good fiction, there's artistry behind good nonfiction, and the key is if you can do it, is finding that artistry.
Yes, sir, in the back.
So around the 80s, Vietnam vets either hid or changed the subject. And I'm just wondering, this is sort of like the 80s for the Iraq-Afghanistan war. What does it feel like to, it doesn't feel like you have to hide. What does it feel like coming back?
Is the question, what does it feel like to live in the 80s?
No, I'm just transporting it. I know the 80s was really hard for Vietnam vets.
So what I would say is that for me personally, it's been, 13 years since my deployment, and I've been out of the military for 10 years now, and I think it was this past weekend when it snowed, I went for a quick run and I came back and I was talking to my wife, Tiana, and I told her, I said, baby, when I was out running, I saw myself running through a rice paddy in Korea. You know, I snow on the ground, just out running through a rice paddy. And, you know, there are those moments that just come back to me personally. Sometimes, you know, you see the same moment at a different angle. And I think, you know, again, just like 13 years, you know, out of Iraq for me, I've just been a lot more, I think as time passes, I get more introspective, what my entire military career was, what it meant to me, what those relationships were, and, I find myself now kind of going back and exploring a lot of those relationships and, you know, reaching out to folks. You know, there's one of my classmates from West Point that's here now, and we bumped into each other a couple of times after graduating, and, you know, again, just to kind of see those faces kind of resurface, like, live when you know, folks like George, who's in the audience, when they show up, and Andrew in the back, and, you know, when they kind of pop up in your memories as well. So that's what I have to say.
One caveat I would add, I think one of the things that's made these wars a little bit, you know, different than Vietnam is, you know, you had a very clear ending there. The helicopters going off the top of the embassy. I mean, it was a long war, but it was done. And these wars kind of have just, like, kept eking into this strange twilight. As I mentioned before, I fought in the Fallujah battle in 2004, and I went back there this past October on a magazine assignment to kind of go walk the battlefield, which I hadn't been to since 2004, which was pretty interesting. And I remember, first of all, the Iraqis thought it was the funniest thing ever. Like, Habibi, what are you doing here? Like, this is, you know, like, are you crazy? And I remember standing, wanting to go find this one building that my platoon had been surrounded in on a pretty dicey day. And I found the building. It was there. And I was looking down from the building, and there was this little cinder block wall. It was, you know, maybe just above my knee and maybe like 6 feet by 4 feet. And I was looking, I was crouching down behind that wall for like 25 minutes pinned down during this one point of this firefight. I'm like, that motherfucking wall is still there. And it's just like this little cinder block wall. So in some respects, you know, there, what it amplifies is how much things have changed. And at the same time, you go back and you realize, you know, as you're looking at the news and you're watching the headlines, you know, on this particular assignment, I happened to be there. It intersected with the beginning of the Mosul battle. So then went up to Mosul and kind of rode along for a couple days of the opening of that battle. I was like, nothing's changed. Like, this place is just, this war is going just like it was going when I was 24. And I think that has made the reckoning of these wars, you know, a little bit different than what we've seen in the past. And I think so, you know, many of the people who are doing the work up here now are kind of trying to get their arms around what that means and what that lack of a conclusion means. And, you know, we'll see.
Yes, ma'am. Yes. When you're not writing about war. But I wonder, for those who are writing about war, do you find that it's harder to be really honest with the reader about what you've gone through than it would be when you're writing about other experiences?
I think part of that is part of good writing for me. Like, when I feel that something is the truest truth that I can make it, then, you know, like I said before, it's kind of, you have to call yourself out or get friends to call you out on your own bullshit. Going back to the fiction question, that's why I love writing fiction now, because you can just make stuff up. You don't have to like eviscerate yourself on the page. You know, you can change details, and it almost feels better even if I'm writing about really hard things, because then you can change them. And even if it did begin as your own personal narrative, if you own the story, you get to write how it ends. And that's pretty cool.
I was just going to, I'll say something quick, that for me, it's actually the opposite. I feel like the stakes are so high in war that it's easy to write about. You don't have to, it's not even embellish. Like, you don't have to find the drama or the meaning or the pathos or whatever there. If you can just accurately relate usually what happened, it's like all of that's already baked in. And so I could, I don't know, that's sometimes why I feel like writing fiction, I find it to be challenging sometimes, because it's like I can get away with it in nonfiction because it really happened. But if I told you this was a story that wasn't true, then it would all sound like too earnest and sentimental and cheesy and all this kind of stuff. But like, if I could just stick to the facts, well, no, all these people really did all of this stuff. And so, I don't know, maybe it's like I'm missing some gene or something where I just, you know, yes, you know, the body parts, and we're really on the ground, and we really did this thing, and we really kicked in that door, and the kids really screamed when we did that, and you know, and that's what happened. And I don't know, I feel the opposite of your question almost. Like, I don't have to couch it. Like, you know, we were in this place, and this is this thing that happened.
When you guys write and sort of you figure out kind of the story you want to convey, and sort of maybe for each of you, is it the individuals involved in maybe in the past in that story that push you toward it, or is it just the subject itself, like maybe say a specific battle and then it encompasses everyone involved?
I don't know that this is a direct answer to your question, but I feel like I'm sitting with a responsibility to tell stories that otherwise aren't getting out. and it's the people I met and cared about, and you know, and they're who just aren't or can't be or never will be heard by the American public, you know, by the people that I'm reaching, and I feel like it's, you know, maybe to answer the last, you know, combine an answer with the last two questions also is that, you know, like this is, you know, in really everywhere, our wars have, you know, are just continue on in these different ways. And, you know, like I feel like the, you know, the interpreters I'm connected with, the people I've met, the, you know, just life keeps unraveling in terrible ways. And I feel like what's the challenge is what's the best way to deliver the stories in a way that people can read and understand in a way. And am I doing justice to the subject matter and the story? And I feel like I'm not, but I'm trying, because people are invisible. You know, I mean that's true of many things, but you know, but this is. These are stories that I have taken in, and I have to put them out in some way. I have to tell people about it, and yeah, it's looking for the, like, how do you deliver that?
Yes, sir.
Hi, thanks for being here and for sharing your stories. You mentioned that a lot of people who go to war or have volunteered themselves, usually at a young age, you know, like 18, 19. Through the 20s. And I'm wondering, with this anthology, will people read the stories and be encouraged to be soldiers, be discouraged from being soldiers? What kind of sense of social responsibility do you feel there? And, you know, how do you yourselves negotiate the sense of the need to share and the need to inspire?
I'll just quickly, like, I'm proud of my military service. It has been an important part of who I am, and if I inspire others to join as well, then I would be pleased with that. And you know, I know other people share different perspectives, but that's mine.
I would just say briefly that there's been thousands of years of war literature that says war is a terrible place, and people keep choosing, especially now in the age of the all-volunteer military, people keep actively choosing to do it. Every Christmas, so my first book, The Long Walk, I would consider that a warning. Like, I went to Iraq, and I did all this stuff, and I was a mess when I came home, and here's how I was a mess. And so, but every year at Christmas, I have college students from like back home in Buffalo say, hey, can we get together for coffee so I can figure out how to be a bomb tech too? And they've read the book, and it's an inspiration. And guess what? If I had read my book when I was 20, I'd like, sign me up, you know? And so it's, I think that there's, I now see the warning in thousands of years of war literature. I see that at age 39. I did not see that at age 19 or, well, 29, honestly.
I mean, joining the military is a highly personal decision, and it sort of picks you on some level. You don't necessarily pick it, and so it can feel like a calling when you go, because you're young, and you know, you're like 18, 19, 20 years old, and nothing's gonna stop you, you know. And yeah, I don't know that I would flatter my writing so much to say that it would like inspire people to go to war. I think those people would probably choose themselves on their own.
Yeah, I would just add too, like, I mean, there's so much film, like, you know, like films like Platoon and like Full Metal Jacket, like those are anti-war movies. Like, you go to any Marine barracks, guys are like watching those movies and cheering, you know? So much of it is like how the person interprets it. And, you know, and I can think of many, many books that I read as I was going into the military, you know, like things like Jim Webb's Fields of Fire is very big with Marines. I remember reading that book at like 21, 22, I was about to be a platoon commander, like really feeling that book. And I remember reading it at like 25, 26, once I'd like had my rifle platoon and had that experience, seen a lot of guys get hurt, and being like, oh, that's what he meant.
Yeah, and what I would say is that I think your question kind of points to kind of intent, right? When you sit down and approach the page, and what I would say is that when I'm writing, I don't have the agenda to, you know, encourage someone to join the military or go to war. It's more of just a very introspective exploration. And, you know, sometimes you know, that exploration can lead to a very kind of detailed description of being in Iraq or Afghanistan or wherever else that you served. But, you know, at other times, you know, you end up with, you know, an egg and cheese sandwich at a bodega. And I think at the end of the day, you know, the for me anyway, the question is, can I, you know, tell this story in a way that you as the reader can come closer to that experience, and you know, the that experience may not, you know, steer you, you know, towards the military or away from it, but it may steer you to look at, you know, kind of a maybe a social issue that's occurring back here in the States. So, you know, again, I think the question kind of like is geared towards, you know, intent when you approach the page, and for me, it's. I think the story opens up when you don't necessarily have kind of that clear endpoint, and you're just kind of writing towards it. You're just kind of feeling it out. That's my process. So.
Other comments, questions? You know, yes, sir.
Your story made me think, it occurred to me that things like CAR and CIB can also be used as tools of external validation for the general public. Like, I see that, okay, that's my combat soldier. I'm pretty loud. Okay.
Sorry, for the video. Yeah, they can be used as tools of kind of external validation. I see that, and I know what a combat soldier looks like. But these stories are all very different, and they're not all, you know, blood and guts and glory and whatnot. So, I mean, do you think the more we write these stories and the more we hear these stories, that changes the perception of what a combat soldier is or what someone who's been to combat is, or does it just kind of reinforce it?
So I'd tackle that with saying that the military has a lot of different aspects to it, and it's not just the, I'd argue, white male infantry war porn that we see in a lot of movies. There's a, no, I mean, love you guys, but but no, there's a long tail. There's a lot more to the military than just the glamorous, you know, glory. And I think Phil Klein's redeployment actually drove that home, because most of the stories in there are not about direct combat. They're about all the rest of the war effort and looking at what America is contributing to this war and the way in which our country is fighting it, and that takes a lot more than you know, the direct combat. So I think part of the intent, and Brian can jump in if I'm wrong here, with these stories was to show the diversity of experience that happens in war and how the toll is even more than you think the blood and guts is, because that's certainly there too, but there's, you know, exponentially more stuff around it.
Yeah, I was at, in that story, you know, the individual in the story who wants his combat action ribbon is not actually an infantryman. And so the military, you know, for anyone who hasn't spent time in it, is like a highly tribal society with all of its sort of secret codes and ribbons. And, you know, I mean, I remember being a kid looking at someone's rack of ribbons and having no idea how anyone could ever understand that. And then, you know, being an officer, you know, meet someone, look at their ribbons, and I can tell you like every deployment they've been on, everything they've done, whether they're a good soldier or a crappy soldier. So it was kind of, you know, so a lot of that is trying to get into that, the structures that exist within the military, which, like Teresa said, are widely varied, but then also have a lot of commonality between them. And I think, you know, I think that's a good thing.
Looking around, I think we've got time for one more question, if there is such a bright, good-looking, and quick, there you are, sir. I knew you were out there somewhere.
I want to hear each of the panelists, and especially Brian's comments on the title of the collection, what does the road ahead mean to you, and what does it mean to all the writers in regard to the story that you placed in the anthology?
So titles are funny things. I think we basically combined every word in the dictionary in three word combinations until we found one that stuck. I don't know. This thing has been titled many things over several years. But I think that the you know a couple years ago the idea was, hey, we're in this thing called the Forever War because it never seems to stop. And then after putting, you know, even while we were doing the collection, Libya happened, and Syria, and Ukraine, and you can go through the list, right? We lost Green Berets in Jordan. We just lost an EOD tech in Syria. So the problem is that the title, The Road Ahead, as in we're moving forward into this road that never ends, it keeps not ending. Like more, it's like less endy all the time. There doesn't even seem to be like a roadblock coming up. So I am not very happy that the impetus of the book and the title keeps becoming more and more appropriate. I don't know who else wants to answer. Peter called us all out, so.
Anybody else?
Well, let me just look around. Anybody else have any one last question? Yes, sir, please. While we're getting the mic here, I just put the panel members, the writers on notice that we'll come back around one last time. And if there's anything that we haven't asked you or you haven't said this evening, you'll have 30 seconds at the end to add that to the mix as we then get a chance to talk with you on a more informal basis. So
question, I wanted to expand a little bit on the question about that. It's the question about inspiration went towards, you know, how you formed it. I wanted to ask more about how do you conceive the audience for your work, right? And do you think about that very much, or is it more you have a story to tell and you're going to try and craft a story to tell it, or do you think about like the people who will be reading it, like, and also the audience would be different, you know, among other veterans or, you know, us, the public, right? We won't have the same frame of reference as other veterans would, right? Do we enter very much in the process of your writing, or is it more like you have a story to tell and needs to be told?
So my day job, which has nothing to do with writing, involves looking for companies to start. And so that process, you know, it in tech is called customer discovery. And I do zero of it when I'm writing, you know, N of one answer. But I just go and write, and then if people want to read what I've written, that's great. But no, I don't think about it at all. Maybe other people have different ways, though.
I would just say I try to write the types of stories that I enjoy to read.
So this is my first piece of fiction, and I think I assume that nobody wants to read my writing, and just to mention Adrian Bonnenberger again, who is, he had this great idea. And I said I want it in. Years later, he had to wrangle me into actually reaching a finishing point where there is now a story in this wonderful anthology among so many other great writers, it was really Adrian who, and I know Brian did a lot of wrangling too, but you know, Adrian was really key to convincing me that this needs to be there. So I do want to thank him, even though he can't be here.
I just want to say Adrian and I sent emails about how do we convince Kristen that her story is great and should be in the collection. So it's a great story, and the collection is better for it. And so it was easy to wrangle.
So any thoughts, any questions, anything that we haven't asked any of you that you would want to throw out for consideration, for reflection?
I have a question for the audience, actually. Right. If you're a veteran and you write about your experience in any context, whether it's a journal or a publication or anything, can you raise your hand? Let's see how many vet writers we have. So everybody look around. There's like a ton of us out here with a ton of different types of experiences. And so all I want to say is it takes all kinds.
Great. Anyone else?
Yeah, I'm going to have folks raise their hand as well. Thanks, Teresa, for not making me do it first. But I just, if you would raise your hand if you have no, if you're a civilian, you've never served. Cool. So I guess the point I want to make is the one I kind of started out with, is that this can't happen without you all as well. You know, it's, for me, it's huge to look out and see this room packed. And raise your hand if you've even read a story out of this book yet. Right? That's a very small number as well. So to come out here and support an event like this and to support veterans like this without even having the chance to crack this open, you know, it speaks for itself. It speaks for just the bond that we have as a group of people, no matter what our background is. I think it speaks for kind of a, you know, I'm gonna venture out into the realm of love that is probably in this room, and I just want to say thank you for being here and for supporting this. Thank you, Brian and Adrian, who isn't here, for just bringing this together and creating an outlet for writers to just kind of do what they do. Appreciate it.
And just to maybe close it out, I also want to say a special thank you to Commissioner Sutton, who is, you know, herself, I hope to read your writing one day, ma'am, but has a long and distinguished career in the United States Army and has been serving our city as the commissioner of what is now the New York City Department of Veterans Services. And in the last year, she's gone from a department of, you know, less than a dozen employees to more than 30 now, and they're doing incredible work for the veterans of New York City and their families. And I wanted to say thank you for taking the time out for veteran writers.
Well, Kristen, let me just pick up on that point. First of all, back at you. Thank you. I would not be in a position of now designing and leading a startup within New York City government. I mean, how cool is that? How often does that happen? Without your advocacy and the convergence of leadership with the mayor, the speaker, the entire city council, but particularly the veterans advocates. And I will tell you, a lot of people don't think of New York City and veteran friendly. They don't put them in the same sentence. Nothing could be further from the truth. And I think, Chris, as you noted, and I think as all of us have sort of basked in this evening, seeing how many, yes, veterans and family members are here, but how many civilians are here as well. The whole notion of reintegration, it's not about just bringing a bunch of veterans back together and forming an enclave. It's about becoming whole again with all of society. And so you ain't seen nothing yet. I'm a huge believer in the role of culture. I'm a psychiatrist. My bias is we have completely over-medicalized. As important as clinical treatment is, we have over-medicalized the path home, the path to wholeness, whether you've been in combat, on a battlefield or in the battlefields here in New York City. And I think you've seen this evening really what richness there is, what courage there is, and what wholeness there is by coming together and sharing these works. So thank you all. Please join me in thanking our veteran writers tonight.